Hi everyone, I'm Tom Slavik and welcome to TSPN's News in Depth this weekend. And I have with me Richard Farrington. He's the president of the Amador Water Agency. We're going to be talking about the McCollumy River and the Moakwise plan, or a Moakwise study, and also AB 142. I think they're all tied. All of these are tied together. If those are the people that remember, Richard, remember last year we had you on quite a number of times because some of the people, and especially the Water Agency, the Board of Supervisors here in Amador County, and a lot of the other water agencies that use the McCollumy, we're basically wanted to weigh in on the trying to make the McCollumy River a wild and scenic designated river here in the state of California, correct?
Correct.
And it looked like it was probably going to go that way, right?
Well, there was a proposed bill last year, SB 1199, and right. It made it through much of the legislature, but it did not make it out of the final committee just because of some questions about it. This year, our assemblyman Frank Bigelow, co-sponsored by Tom Berryhill, have proposed Assembly Bill 142, and 142 is essentially a study to determine the impact or potential impact of a McCollumy Wild and Scenic designation on our water supplies.
Okay, so specifically that's doing that. Let's go back a little bit to the study of Moakwise. Is the study of the Moakwise still going on?
Moakwise, yes. As our government agencies, in particular water agencies and county governments, throughout the whole McCollumy watershed, down including San Joaquin County, so Amador, Calaveras, San Joaquin. And there are also a number of private groups called NGOs, that's non-government associations, locally Foothill Conservancy, et cetera, are participating in this Moakwise study, reviewing the various aspects of the water and potential projects to improve the environment and help with our water supplies.
So this was a study that was going on, and during this study, I believe the water bill to try to make it wild and scenic came up, and a lot of the proponents, Amador Water Agency being one that I know of, they wanted to say, well, let's hold off, let's find out what this study does. We were already spending pretty good chunk of money. I forget the how much. You might be able to
close
point that out.
Close to $900,000 grant, right, for this baseline work and looking at all kinds of a whole range of projects, including, you know, conservation, reuse, recycling, potential new sources of water, groundwater recharge, all of these kinds of things that, and then looking at the amount of water in the that comes out of the McCollumy watershed as a whole.
Right, and if anybody's watching today, I think they would know from California, we're in the fourth year of the drought.
Very serious drought,
and all of those things that you were talking about, water, wastewater, all of the various uses, they're very much hot button issues right today. So it kind of seems to me that we would want to look at the Moak and see the McCollumy River and try to find out what it is, how we can best use that river.
Exactly.
Now, at the time in those studies, I believe that the Wild and Scenic was also in the study to look at it with the Moakwise.
In the Moakwise process, it was initially proposed, but then when it did not get a sponsor, after a few months, then it was dropped, and so it's no longer being considered. And I think that may be partly the reason for the initiation of this AB Assembly Bill 142 by Assemblyman Frank Bigelow, our elected representative here in the Assembly, to require an impact study on our water supplies, particularly in this drought, going into 4 years, and we've got one water scientist saying that California only has 1 year of water left. Well, I'm not even sure. Maybe that's for the statewide, but I'm not even sure we have that much.
So. Right, and I have just read a couple of news stories that some climatologists believe that we're probably in just coming out of a wet time in a thousand-year cycle, which is, I guess that's fairly scary to think of if we're going on to the round, on the downside. And they were trying to say that's why California wasn't much developed at the time that we became a state or anything. The water just really isn't the places where the people want to live.
Right. There's a new research report or study that a scientist has done predicting that there's an 80% chance at least of a 10-year drought. Australia just got through with a 15-year drought, so it isn't that unusual. If you look back in history, and in this global or global, not global warming, but they're calling it climate change now, would have to be considered. And you know, there's been debate about climate change, but the climate has been changing ever since the glaciers started melting 10,000 years ago. You know, where are they? One third of the U.S. was covered with glaciers. Mm-hmm. So we have a natural warming cycle that's occurring overall, and the researchers are saying that this is going to mean longer droughts for us. And
if I can interject a little bit, it's, you know, we all know what's been dry out here, but we've all been hearing about the East Coast has got record snowfall, record this and that. We could certainly have used it. So some places nice and dry in the U.S. and other places it's more than wet. Mother Nature doesn't distribute stuff evenly or necessarily where it's needed.
Right. That's part of this climate change is the weather patterns can shift around the earth. And so, you know, and if we're looking at there was a 200-year drought 800 years ago. So that this could very well, that was a drier period, the wetter period we've been in, as you're saying, and maybe we're going back into a drier period.
Okay. Well, it would seem like basically the concept of global warming is saying, well, we don't know if it's that, but it's changing. So
it
seems to
change,
be that...
Not global warming.
I'm just trying to say, what God kind of points out to me is like, you know, we're really not sure where things go. And when you're really not sure, it doesn't, to me, seem to make a lot of sense to dedicate things to certain areas where we can't look at them. And I kind of think that's what the designation Wild and Scenic does. I could be wrong.
So let me just interrupt you here on this AB 142.
Right.
This is an impact analysis, really, on the what are the impacts that could be triggered by this designation of the McCallumy as a wild and scenic. It's like doing an environmental impact report, and we have to do those all the time to address things on the impacts on the environment or possible growth-inducing impacts if we increase the size of a water pipe. So in this case, we're afraid that this designation, if we're not careful, could reduce our water rights and our water supplies. And so we think it's very fair to do an environmental impact report. And that's what AB 142. And it's really not new. The existing state law already requires a study of wild and scenic suitability and also must address the water and land use implications. In this case, we've also 142 would require addressing potential climate change. So if we really are going into a 10 or 15 year drought, then, you know, we need to be considering that as well.
Okay. Now, another thing that might be working favorably, at least from my point of view, and that is that Calaveras has Board of Supervisors has weighed in differently than last year. You were just at that meeting. You want to flesh that out for people?
Yeah, Wednesday, the Calaveras Board of Supervisors voted to support this AB 142, and so that. Between our two counties, both sides of the river, the two county supervisors, boards of supervisors, seven water agencies, and five cities all have voted to support AB 142.
Now, all those people you mentioned, is that CAMRA, or the makeup of CAMRA, or is CAMRA another entity?
Well, CAMRA is kind of an entity. That's the Calaveras, Amador, McCallumy River Authority. It's a joint powers authority. It's made up of members of many of those that I just mentioned, the counties, the different water agencies. The cities were not included in CAMRA, and as I said, we have the five cities in Amador County, plus the Amador Business Council, have all voted to support 142.
So
we have really strong support for it.
Okay, so last night, did Amador City weigh in favor of this
yes.
as well?
That's one of the five. Yeah. Amador City voted yes. It was 4-0 and one abstention. One member said that he, for some reason, didn't get a copy of the bill to look at, so he was going to be reluctant, but still, you know, it was 4-0 in favor of 142.
Okay. So we have another minute on this segment. So what else is working in favor for this right now? I think one thing that's working in favor is to the seriousness of the drought. Yesterday, I believe we had, you know, Governor Jerry Brown to say we've got $1.3 billion.
Dollars. It sounds like he's going to. Well, Proposition 1 was passed in November. It was like $7.1 billion, I think, approved for water-related projects. I think what he's doing is accelerating. $1 billion of that.
I think he's looking to. It sounded like, and we'll get back with this. Well, just mention. It sounded like he was saying, if we have any shovel-ready things out there, things that we're used to the language that need the money, let's look at those projects. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. Stay with us.